Hi, everyone. Welcome to the next episode of the Two Stone Dudes Podcast. This is your co-host, Ryan Castle, with...
Rob Denai.
And...
Jamie.
And...
Mondo Homunculero.
Yeah! Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 2 of season 7. We have a special guest on tonight. We're going to let Jamie introduce her later on this next segment. We're going to have Rob with current events. And Mondo, I don't know what you're going to have planned. I don't know if we had anything going on today, but me and you could just talk about what Rob had going on when he talks about what he finds out about it.
We can
so that'll work out. Yeah.
We're on the fly.
That'll work out. Well, ladies and gentlemen, join us here in the next couple of minutes for the segment with Jamie and her guest. We'll see you soon.
What's up, everybody out there in 420 land? This is the co-host of Two Stone Dudes Podcast, Ryan Castle. The Anchor app is where I got my start, and it's been amazing being a podcast host so far because of Anchor. Let me explain. It's the easiest way to make a podcast for free. That's right, it's free. Anchor then distributes your podcast to Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and so many more. And I won't forget about the creation tools that allow you to edit your podcast from your phone or your PC. And you can get paid with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make your very own podcast. Download the free app or go to anchor.fm.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the next segment of Two Stone Dudes Podcast. We got Jamie B. Jamie, give us a scoop on what's going on. What do you have for us today as you're choking on a blunt?
So I got Raquel Darringer. She used to...
The
yes, Raquel Darringer. The Raquel Darringer. She's a model, but...
She's more than a model.
Right.
She's very talented.
So I'll just jump into questions.
Sure.
Like, right away.
So let's
Hi, everybody.
Hey, how you doing, Raquel?
I'm fine.
Right on. Thank you
for having me on.
Oh, thank you so much for being on. We greatly, greatly appreciate it. I just have to put this out there. Me and Rob recognized you from Jamie says his text message.
I hope that's a good thing.
From Jen. Like, we recognized you. I was like, oh my, I had that.
No,
thank you. That's all I have to say.
No. Let me tell you very quickly. I have to let this out here. That one particular magazine was not supposed to ever happen.
Really?
That photo shoot was a flop. And I had done a photo shoot with my photographer. I believe his last name is Sparks. And they had wanted me to gain a little bit of weight because I was really too skinny for a lot of the magazines that I was shooting for, because I was also a fitness competitor. Mm-hmm. So they wanted me to gain a little bit of weight for a shoot, and I was like, okay, you know, I can have a couple of cupcakes. That's fine. and I did. And to me, I had too many cupcakes, and then I had another breast augmentation. So my breasts were way too high, and I looked a little thicker. We took the photos, and I said no on all of them. I was like, nope, I'm not, no. So I signed off on them. And when a model signs off on photos, if you sign off and leave them with a photographer that might not have the best integrity, they can use those photos for whatever they want. So they can go and submit them to whatever magazines they want, and whatever magazine wants to pick them up and buy them from the photographer can do so. So the first time I ever found out that I did not only the cover of Jen magazine, but the centerfold inside was... I was at another book signing, and this guy walks up to me with the magazine and is like, can you sign this? And I'm looking at it like, wait a minute, that's me, but what is this? And he's like, what do you mean, what is it? I'm like, this is magazine. I called my agent immediately, and I was kind of upset about it, because it was definitely, that was the worst shoot. That was my least favorite shoot ever.
Oh my God, I'm so sorry. It's horrible, man.
From the color of the bathing suit to My makeup, everything was just horrible. So if you guys like me and Jen, amazing. You need to find me in a good magazine like Playboy or Penthouse or, you know, one of the good magazines. Sorry. You start out like, we saw you in Jet. I'm like, oh my God. Man, the worst one.
Oh, well, if that's your worst
Hey, if that's your worst one, you did pretty good. Yeah. Right? Come on.
Thanks a lot, guys. It's all great. That makes you feel good.
All right, let's let Jamie get to her questions here. Go ahead, Jamie. It's up to you.
Absolutely.
All right, so just so our listeners have an idea on, like, what you did for a living, can you give us examples of magazines or companies that you have been featured posing for?
Sure. I started modeling when I was 17 years old, and that was for 17 Magazine, actually. Oh, I had done a contest. I was still in school, and there was a contest for, you know, the prettiest face or something. And I was in the board. I wasn't exactly 17 yet, so I went ahead and I submitted the pictures, and I just had just a local photographer take the pictures, and I ended up getting the job, winning the contest. So it got me a little. I was always infatuated with, like, models and what they did, and I thought it was really cool. So once that happened, I really was like, wow, I want to do this again once I did that photo shoot. And from there, it was no bars old. Like, I got picked up by Playboy. Playboy was the first, actually, to ask me to do any type of modeling, and I said no. I was on the beach in Miami, and someone had just walked up to me on the beach, and they're like, hey, you ever done any modeling? And I'm like, not really. I mean, some. But he's like, well, you know, Playboy. And the second I heard Playboy, at the time, you know, being so young, I was like, no. Yeah. I'm not really interested. So after that, I started getting, I was approached again in New York City. And I was on vacation, and I was approached again if I wanted to do some modeling. So finally, I was just like, you know what? Maybe this is my calling. So I went ahead, and then from there, like I said, at Playboy, Penthouse, Maxim. I did a lot of stuff for Giovanni, Versace in Dubai and Italy. So I traveled all over the world to do my modeling. I was voted one of the 100 most beautiful women. It was a coffee book edition sold at Barnes and Noble.
Nice.
So I did that. Yeah, I did. I've done quite a bit. I did quite a bit all over the world.
Right on.
All right. What advice would you give someone interested in the same line of work?
I would probably, honestly, say just choose very carefully your agent, and really pay attention to, like, contracts. Because, again, like Gent Magazine, for instance, when you're modeling, and there's two ways of doing modeling. One, you can have your agent pretty much get jobs for you, magazine jobs, runway jobs, you know, appearances, whatever, and you give them a percentage of money, and they get your work for you all over, wherever. And you pay them a percentage, and then you get the rest of whatever the set amount is that is negotiated with the company, the magazine, whatever it is that, you know, is wanting to do the photo shoot with you. You have to be very careful sometimes and read the fine lines, or have a good agent, because, again, sometimes, especially with me being young with Gent, you can sign away a whole photo shoot that can be used over and over and over again. And for one, you're not getting paid any money for that photo shoot. So they're getting money each time a photographer submits, and they say that Sparks had submitted that photo shoot to another, unless they had made like an agreement with Gent, then he could have submitted it to another magazine. Another magazine could have bought it from him, and he would have gotten money from it again, which is fine. It's okay that the photographer is getting paid for his work, because you've already gotten paid for that photo shoot. But you kind of sell yourself short, because you have no idea where that shoot is going to go. If you don't care, then that's fine.
Right.
But again, you know, Gent Magazine was not one of my absolute, you know, after you've done Playboy and Penthouse and, you know, Maxim and FHM and, you know, all the magazines that I did, then Gent kind of like becomes a little bit of the bottom of the barrel for me. And I'm like, ah, I wish they would have never put that out. Right. So I would just say just to be a little, to be very careful of what you sign and just, you know, use your gut feeling when it comes to photographers and agents, because some of them out there are not as, their integrity is not as good as others. So I would definitely just be diligent, just be very careful. Be, you know, read your contracts and stuff, because sometimes they can hide some things in there. Like, for instance, this is something that a lot of people probably don't know. When you sign for Playboy, or if you pose for Playboy in any of their magazines, whether it be a Playboy Bunny, Centerfold, or if you just Playgirl's lingerie, or Playboy's lingerie, whatever, if you sign a contract with them, they can hold you to the contract for 4 years. And really? Then what that does is it, yeah, and it binds you from being able to pose for, you know, competition magazines such as Penthouse and Hustler. Huh. So that's the reason why I actually never did the cover, was I was not willing to sign a 4-year contract with Playboy Incorporated, because I felt like, first of all, you would have had to have gone to, and I don't mean to bash Playboy by no means. Playboy is a great magazine, and it's a good magazine for aspiring models to get started with. I mean, it's, you know, it's mm-hmm. Playboy. But there's a lot of things that you don't know about at first. You know, you're like, oh, you've been asked to do Playboy. You sit down and you look at the contracts and stuff. And then that's when they're like, okay, well, listen, you know, if you want to do the cover, if you ever want to do the cover, here's how this works. And what, like I said, it's 4 years. You can't pose for any other, you know, competition magazine, and you have to show up to a certain amount of parties at the mansion. There's a lot of things that come with it. So that a lot of people ask me, like, why didn't you ever do the cover? You could have definitely, you know, been Playmate of the Year, or, you know, ran for the cover. And I'm like, you know what? Because I wasn't willing to sign away 4 years and not be able to do other magazines and have to go to the mansion and stay at the mansion when I didn't want to. Modeling to me is supposed to be fun, and was fun for me. I never wanted to feel like it was locking me into anything or locking me down to something.
Right.
So that's just a little tidbit for people, like, you know, that might not know about Playboy, is, you know, the girls that do the covers, you're locked. You're locked in there for 4 years, and you're, you know, even though I did enjoy the parties and stuff like that, I went on my own. Or you know, I went like, oh, I think I'll go to this party this year or this party. I didn't have to go, you know, and dress as a Playboy bunny or anything like that. I was just, you know, one of their Playboy girls, and that's how it went. And it was great.
Nice.
Yeah. So I remember you telling a story one day about running into a serial killer at Wolf Creek. Can you tell?
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
Yes, absolutely. Well, I had done the Australian Penthouse, and this was in the early 90s that I had first flown over to Australia. And there was someone by the name of the backpack murderer in Wolf Creek. Well, my husband at the time and I were over there, and I had done a photo shoot, and we had loved Australia so much that I was like, I don't want to leave. So how can I stay longer than, you know, than my photo shoot and everything? How can I stay longer than that? I don't want to leave. And so I started surfing, and I actually became a pro surfer. I'd always surfed in Florida and skimboarded, and I ended up becoming a pro. And so I started doing contests and stuff over there. So then I started getting sponsors. So I was over there. So it was good. So I had a house, I had cars. We were over there living there. And we had traveled all over Australia, not only just water wise, but the outback as well. And we went out hiking one day, and my husband decided to take like a left turn and I took a right turn. But I mean, we figured we were, you know, we were close enough to each other to where, you know, we were safe, and thank God, because I am literally, and I showed you the picture. So I'm, you know, I'm kind of hiking and just kind of looking at the different plants and taking pictures and, you know, just enjoying the day. It was a little bit cold out, so I had on a sweater. And I remember I didn't have a backpack, because he was like the backpack considered later on. I found out the backpack murders. I was hiking and this gentleman walked up to me, and I'm pretty used to getting approached, so it wasn't something that was startling to me. I was like, oh, well, a guy's walking up. Okay. Maybe wants my autograph or something. I don't know. Right. And so he comes up and he's like, hey, he did a little bit of small talk and I did a little small talk and everything seemed fine. And everything, I mean, the whole situation was fine. He had, asked where I was from. He had noticed that I didn't have an accent, you know, just kept kind of small talking with me. And then he said, are you here alone? And one thing that I thought that was very odd and weird was we were on a really, I mean, a very, very, very like major cliff, like legitimately, if he wanted to push me, he could have pushed me and I would have gone down hundreds of feet, and we were right there on the ledge. I don't know, I guess because I was young, I just did not pay attention of things that might not be so safe to do. But yeah, so I'm sitting there talking to him and he's like, are you here alone? And I said, oh no, I'm not. My husband's here somewhere. He's somewhere on the trail, you know? And he's like, oh, so his demeanor changed. But at the time it really did not even sink in at all that I would have been in any type of danger or this guy was, you know, had any issues. It just seemed like a guy hiking, and he had said that there was someone else out there hiking with him. And so, and he had kind of done the same thing. He kind of went by himself, and, but he wasn't dressed. One thing after everything was said and done, after I'd actually watched the movie, and then I went and I dug and I found a photo of him and he wasn't dressed for hiking by no means. Oh. I mean, he was wearing a leather jacket. And again, like Jamie, I showed you the picture, like he definitely did not look like a hiker, where me, I had on like sneakers, you know, shorts. And then I had like two layer, you know, a shirt and then like a sweater type thing over, you know? And, so I didn't really pay attention at first, you know? And so my husband ended up coming around and the guy was like, you know, again, this is hindsight. He seemed a little startled after that. You know, my husband came up and I was like, well, let's take a picture. You know, let's take a picture. So, and I really can't remember how the picture went. If he asked or if I asked, I probably asked myself, just because I was taking pictures of everything and documenting everything that I did and, you know, putting it in my books and whatever. And so I ended up getting a picture with him by myself. My husband had taken the picture and it was in my camera roll. So, you know, okay, thanks. Have a happy trip. Be careful. Don't fall. Don't murder anyone. See you later. And so we left not knowing anything. And then it took a couple of years, because remember, this was in the early 90s. We had come home, and then it had taken a couple of years for them to come out with a movie called Wolf Creek. Well, one of my friends had watched the movie, and she had seen the pictures and everything, because back in the day, you know, this is when you saw how to get like film developed, like you couldn't, you know, digitally just get it developed. You had to go and get it developed. And she had seen the picture, and because I went back to Australia, I went back, and she's like, oh my God. She's like, did you ever hear about the Wolf Creek murders? And I'm like, Wolf Creek, where's that at? She's like, oh my God, you were hiking over there. It's over like Western Australia. And I'm like, I do remember. I mean, I've hiked all over the place, but so she's like, you need to watch the movie Wolf Creek. So I'm like, okay. So I watched it, and then I like put two and two together. And I'm like,
and then you dug the picture.
So I took the picture. I took the picture and I called the Australian police and I said, hey, listen, I think, well, actually, yeah, Wolf Creek came out. Yeah, Wolf Creek came out after. Because I ended up sending the picture to the police because I was like, is this the guy? So I sent it to the Australian police, a copy of it to the Australian police. And sure enough, it was the actual, and I've got to think of his name. It was the actual murderer that had taken the lives, I think, of 8 backpackers. Wow. That were around my age at the time. Yeah. It was, I'm trying to think of his name. Yvonne, I think his name was. But yeah. So,
that's wild.
Yeah, cutting it close to getting myself in a really tight place would have been, right, if my husband would not have been there. I still to this day wonder, like, whew, what would have happened? But yeah, so yeah, I do have a picture, and it is of him, and it's him and I standing there on the trail, and I'm not wearing a backpack, but yeah, he went on to murder, like, I don't know, like 8 teenager, younger people. And at the time I was only like 19, so 19, 20. Yeah. Huh. So it wasn't scary anymore because it had been years after I had found out, but I definitely was like, oh my God, I cannot believe that I was that close to someone who was murdering people, and was I supposed to be one of his victims if it wasn't
that's
for my husband?
So shit.
It was definitely kind of scary after that. Now it made me become more
aware,
more apt to paying attention to where aware of like people coming up and wanting to take my picture or people just in general coming up, because he seemed very nice and normal, and sure enough, it was when I sent the picture to the Australian police and they identified him as the person, I was like, oh my, like, he had his arms around me.
Oh, God.
So it definitely was, it was a little bit bone chilling.
That's fucking crazy. Shit.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. That's what I say now. It was fucking crazy. Yeah. It was, Just to know, you know, that because I had gone hiking before by myself, but never like on a huge trail. This was in like in a park type setting. And so you kind of feel safe, like, oh, you know, your way back out. It's okay. So, I mean, I very well could have been out there that day by myself. And if it weren't for, I mean, he legitimately was like, so are you out here by yourself? And I'm like, oh no, smacking on gum or whatever. You know, I'm very young. I'm like, no, my husband's here. And then that's when he kind of like, was like, oh, okay. So it was kind of like, I'm assuming like a back off, like, well, can't do anything with this one because, you know, Mike, my husband at the time, was a very, very tall and large guy, and he definitely wouldn't have wanted to mess with him in any way. So that, I guess, it spoiled his plans. Raquel got to live.
Wow, what a story!
So yeah, it was like crazy, but it ended well for me.
That's good. So. Did you ever see the movie Wolf Creek, Pat? Wolf Creek, yeah. You ever see that?
You guys have to watch it. And
I
then
did.
Now know.
I saw it. Yeah, I saw the 1 and 2, and then there's a series now.
Huh.
What?
Well, I think they kind of played on it because I had not looked it up or anything in a long time. And when I was talking to Jamie about it, I don't know when it came up, and I said, you know, oh, you guys have to watch Wolf Creek. I even looked up and realized that there was other ones, and they kind of like spun off of the true story. And then I haven't seen 2 or 3. I'm going to have to watch that now. I don't think that's off of any type of true story, but definitely the first one definitely is because I was there and
right.
I know.
Right.
So I don't know what 2 and 3 is about. Is it still about the murders? You said you watched all of them.
Yeah. I've run them all.
So what happened? I mean, because the first one, they caught him. They caught the guy. Did they have like a copycat or?
No, the guy broke free. He got loose in two and three.
Oh my God! And then, Jesus!
And then in the season, right in the TV show, it goes back before. It was a prologue, and it shows. Yeah.
Whoa! I'm gonna definitely have to watch. It's gonna freak me out because, my goodness!
Was this guy?
You just don't know. You don't know.
Was this guy older guy? Was he like it is? Late 30s, early 40s type of guy?
He wasn't like, there wasn't anything really strange looking about him or anything. Oh. He looked like he was like maybe in his late 30s to me.
Okay.
But I'm not a real good, judge of age. I mean, probably early 40s. Yeah. I remember he had a little bit of a, like his eye kind of turned a little bit. Like that was the only thing that I kind of remembered about him.
Okay.
But he just looked like a normal guy. And
except for wearing a leather
jacket. Along with all the other normal guys that I thought were normal that weren't normal. Yeah, he wasn't at all. He was he was looking for people to murder.
Right.
Maybe it was I wasn't wearing a backpack. I don't know.
That's what saved you.
Yeah, that's what saved me. She's not wearing a backpack. Shit. We can't. She's not wearing a freaking backpack. It's my calling card. And I don't have an extra one out here in the Outback. So she gets to live another day.
Imagine if that's what really made the difference. Oh, my God.
Listen, if it did, I'm so... Because I was bitching about the fact that I didn't have water. And I had told Mike, I'm like, because we had just gone out there just to take a couple of photos. And because I wanted to, literally, we had traveled the whole entire proximity of Australia. It took me 5 years. So mainly I stayed on the ocean because, of course, of me surfing and scuba diving and all that kept me close to the waters. But then as we moved inward to the outback and, places like that, we took pictures of, the different types of trees and stuff because I mean, it was absolutely beautiful. But never in a million years. And sometimes we would stop. Like I literally, when I first, and this is just off the brand story, but it's still, I'm in Australia. When I first got there, I was so like there are like, there's birds over there that people like put in cages here as pets, and they're flying around like, they're wild. So when I first got there, I got my apartment, everything like, what is that white bird called that has like the big yellow like thing on top of its head?
Cockatoo.
Yeah. It's like flying around. Like it's flying around and like, oh my God, somebody's pet got loose. And like, no mate. That's like, they just fly. And I'm like, oh my God. Oh, like, cause we cage them. We cage them in America and we sell them as pets. And they're like flying around. Like there's lovebirds in this tree. And you're like, oh my God, some of these lovebirds got lost. And it's like, no, they live out there. Like that's where they live. So we were driving and I had yet to see a koala bear in the wild. And I thought, oh my God, they're so cute. They're so furry. They're so adorable. I want one. And we're driving down, down a road somewhere in Australia. And I just happened to look up and there's a freaking koala bear in a tree. So I'm like, stop the car. There is a freaking koala bear in the tree. I want it. Because they look so cute, you could probably just go right up like a sloth kind of thing and just grab it and then like, put it in your car, feed it some like eucalyptus or whatever, and it'd be nice. Fuck no. No. Oh, I'm sorry. Am I? Oh, gosh.
No, that's cool.
Listen. Are we allowed to? Am I allowed to?
Yeah.
Like a potty mouth sometimes. Especially when I get excited. Okay, well, listen to me. They're the meanest fucking animals ever. Like, oh, my God. I got out of my car, and I'm like, hey. God. That thing, first of all, had claws on it that were like 4 inches long a piece. And it's like, claw, like clipped to the tree, like a little clip on. And I'm like, hey, little, koala bear, come down. Here's some eucalyptus. You know, and I'm waving at it. It starts barking. I'm waiting, and my husband's in the car like, Raquel, I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing. I want this. So I'm like sticking a stick at it, and you know, I'm not poking it or anything. I'm not trying to be mean. I want him. Like, I want him to be friends with me. I want a koala bear. And until he barked at me. Then I was like, fuck no. Like, get in the car, drive away. I'm afraid he's gonna follow me. Like, they are the meanest freaking furry animals you will ever, ever come across in your life. They're so mean, and they don't make like cute little teet-teet sounds or anything like that. They sound like a freaking dinosaur. This thing was barking at me. It was barking at me. The only thing it didn't do is jump on me. Like, I was, you know, thank God I didn't poke it with the stick, because I might have pissed it off and it would have jumped on me. Probably. But, I mean, I'm, like, waving the little stick at it, like, just come down, you know, little koala bear. And, I mean, he barked at me, and I was like, whoa, got in the car, and I'm like, I don't like koala bears anymore. And so then when we saw them, I ended up seeing one at the zoo, because I was too afraid to even approach. I stopped looking at trees. I'm like, I am not even going to look, because I don't even want to think to see. When they say everything wants to kill you in Australia, even the kangaroo aren't nice. Like, they'll knock the shit out of you. Yeah, if you see a kangaroo, don't be like, oh, it's a kangaroo, let me pet it. No, that thing will knock your ass across the street. Like, they are not nice animals. None of them over there. There's no animals over there that are nice. I'm going to tell you that right now, unless you buy, like, a Pomeranian puppy and you bring it home or something like that. None of them are nice. Not even the birds. Like, don't try to pet a wild bird. Don't try to pet a wild koala. Don't try to approach, you know, a wallaby or a kangaroo, because they'll take your ass out quick. Just like just about as bad as a brown recluse, I swear to God.
Oh, my God.
Everything over there wants to kill you. When they say everything in Australia wants to kill you, even the people, they are telling the truth.
Shit.
So, yeah, don't go to Australia and try to catch a koala bear. It will not end well.
Right.
I got lucky. I got lucky. I escaped death from a koala bear because I didn't stick with a stick. I was nice and just kind of waved it at him, and he was like, not freaking out. He's like, not today, Satan. Go away. And I jumped in my car and was like, nope, that's not for me.
I choose.
Listen, guys, Australia. And then I had one more thing in Australia. When I first moved into one of my houses, I had to rent a castle. I don't ask why. I was a little extra. When I lived in Australia, for one, the money exchange was so different, because the American dollar was worth two Australian dollars.
What?
So, yes. So it was like, everything, you know, I got paid $100 for something, American money, which everything that I ever did was always, no matter what country I went to, always you had to pay me in American money. I didn't want to have to transfer it or, you know, exchange anything. Not Raquel Darringer. You have to do it my way. And so let's just say $100 American money, it automatically turns into $200 Australian. And, like, a gallon of milk was the same price as American gallon of milk. Gas was, like, about the same price. So, I mean, you were loaded. Like, if you had, you know, quite a bit of money in America and you brought it to Australia, you were pretty loaded. Nice. You were double the money. So that was one reason why I really liked being there, because, you know, the money exchange was crazy. It was double. So it was definitely a major experience that I will never forget.
Do you guys have any questions for her?
No, I'm good, man.
I have one more question for you.
Okay.
Have you ever been arrested?
Oh, I've ever been arrested?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I have a story. Okay. oh, my God. Okay, so I live in a really small town, and I became a pretty big model, but I came home a lot to see my family, and you know, and I used to drive Ferraris and stuff. So, I mean, I would drive, I'd get pulled over, and I'd be kind of like a smart ass. I'd be like, you know, the typical, like, do you know how fast we're going? And I'm like, yeah, I was probably going way over the speed limit. Do you see my car? You know, it starts off at 70. Like, I'm already speeding right at the get-go. So, I mean, I was a smart ass, and, you know, they didn't like me very much. So they always gave me tickets. And I would just take the ticket, and I'd be like, I'll pay it later. And I'd wad it up and throw it on the floorboard. No, you know, no big deal. Uh-huh. And it caught up to me. I had gotten so many tickets over the years because I would leave. Like, I might be in Florida for like a week, and of course I get pulled over for speeding because, you know, I used to speed like all the time. I get a ticket, and then I'd, you know, be like, oh well, I'll pay for it later or whatever. And then I'd leave, and I'd go like Europe or Dubai or wherever, and I'm not over there thinking like, oh god, I got that ticket to pay. Like, that's the least of my, you know, I'm over there like, yay, yeah, I'm fine. So I'm not worried about it. So then when I get back to America, I'm also not like, oh, I got that ticket to pay or those 10 tickets to pay. I'm seeing my family and I'm seeing my friends. So I totally forgot, you know? So I was speeding, and no, I wasn't. This was the only time. Like, I wasn't speeding, and I was driving to my parents' ranch. And when you go there, there's like this hairpin. And once you hit this hairpin, you cannot see anybody behind you. So if there are cops that happen to be like trying to get you to pull over, and you're not really paying attention, and you hit that hairpin, then you're not going to see them. So you're just going to keep driving, right? So I'm in like this little red sports car, and I pull up to my parents. It's a dirt road. There is nowhere for it to go. And I pull up, and the fence wasn't working. So my niece happened to be in the car with me. And at that day, because my niece was in the car and this was a very small sports car, I was not speeding. So I did see the cop pass by me. I did see him pass by me. And I thought to myself, oh, you know, I'm not speeding. You know, I've got my seatbelts on. You know, I've got my niece in the car. So we stop, and these cops fly by, and we hear the sirens. We're like, oh, somebody's in trouble, you know. And then all of a sudden, they're coming down the dirt road. And I'm like, oh, shit. Like, what? So they get out. They're like, get out of the car. And I'm like, what the hell? So I get out of the car, and they're like, don't move. And I'm like, I'm, you know, in a pair of Prada, like little flip flops and no bra with a sweater and a mini, like, where the fuck am I going? Like, okay, I'm here. And they come up and they're like, you know, let's see, where's your driver's license and registration and all that. And I'm like, oh my God, my boyfriend ends up coming up on a four wheel. And he's like, what's going on? And they're like, first of all, she was fleeing. And I'm like, I was what? And they're like, I called them frickin' frack. I'm like, frickin' frack, listen. Cause I was such a smart ass back then. You guys have no idea. I'm like, frickin' frack, listen. For one, like, what is fleeing what? Like, I'm in a, do you see I'm dressed? Like, where am I going? I'm on a dirt road. I have, what do you think? I have a, you know, like an invisible Cessna in my backyard. The airport's across the street. I'd be on the wrong side of the road if I'm fleeing. Where am I going? And they're like, well, you're also impersonating a cop. I'm driving a red Tiburon, guys. It's a red Tiburon. It looks nothing like a freaking cop car. But apparently it had blue little PL lights on the bottom of it, the little blue shiny PL lights, which only come on when you drive.
You're
so
stretching.
It was my boyfriend's car. So I never knew that when you, I never saw them really, because I'm always, they don't run when the car stopped. They were like air propelled or something. So I didn't even know what they were. So my boyfriend goes out there, he flashes his VA card, which did nothing for frickin' frack. Like, they didn't care. And so my boyfriend at the time, he had ripped the, he goes, you know, she's impersonating a cop. So he went literally and ripped the lights off of the car and threw them in the woods. He's like, there, that takes care of that. Well, they ran my name, and it said failure to appear. So get this. Oh. My parents are in New York on vacation, coming home that day. And I'm like their baby. I'm the oldest of three, but I am definitely the baby of the three. my two little sisters are like my big sisters. So they come back. They're like, well, just sit here. You know, let us run your license. And I'm like, okay. You know, so I'm sitting there. You know, my boyfriend's sitting on the on a four-wheeler. My niece is sitting there, and my parents are going to be coming in, like, anytime, you know, with their RV. They just had a horrendous vacation driving an RV through New York City. It was crazy. So they come back to me, and they're like, we're going to have to take you in. And I'm like, yeah, you know, that doesn't really fit into my schedule today because my parents are coming back from New York and they really probably not going to be in that good of a mood because driving an RV they figured would be a good idea in Manhattan ended up not being a good idea. So, and then driving all the way home and all that, they're not really going to be in that big of a, you know, a happy mood. So today would not be the day for me to like do anything like that, to participate. So I'm going to no on that. That's going to be a negative. And they did not like my tone or my sarcasm. So they were like, yeah, no, we're going to arrest you. And I'm like, this is not the type that I like, the time I like to be like, well, they got me. They said, can you stand up? And I'm like, okay. And I'm looking at my boyfriend, my niece. She's only like 9, 10. And she's like, oh my God, you know? And they started putting handcuffs on me. I'm like, listen, this is not the time for this. Like, this is not, they're not pink. They don't have like, you know, fur around. Like, no, like that's, this is not going to work for me. And they're like, yeah, it's protocol. And so I said, you know, could you please just not do that in front of my niece? And they were nice and did not, but they did kind of move me over. They did handcuff me. And they put me in the back of their police car and I got arrested. And this is just a little bit of long. It's not going to be too long, but it's a little bit of a long story. So they arrested me and I told my boyfriend, I said, listen, call the bail bondsman, Jimmy. I'm not giving last names, Jimmy, because he grew up with my parents. So he was like my uncle and he was the bail bonds. And so I was like, call Jimmy. And tell him that I'm being arrested and to bail me out immediately. So, you know, I don't exactly know how this works, but have him ready for me to get out, like, before I even get in. And so Chris did not know where he was going. So I asked the police, I'm like, can he just follow us so he can go right across the street and go ahead and get the bail ready or whatever? And because I kept telling them, I'm like, listen, this is a mistake. A failure to appear. I've never gotten in any type of trouble other than, you know, speeding tickets. And, you know, so, I mean, this is a mistake. And they even showed me on their computer. They're like, look, here's your name. Here's your birthday. And it says failure to appear. So I'm like, oh, well, it does say that. But I mean, I'm telling you, like, can I get a ticket and just appear? They're like, no, because you apparently failed to appear the first time. And I'm like, oh my God, this is so bad. So they end up bringing me into jail and I go into like the like holding area where there's no people. So I already have like a little bit of an anxiety problem and I'm literally like in this teeny little mini skirt and like no bra. I've got on this like little cute little sweater and like my little Prada shoes. And, you know, so I'm sitting in this dirt, like this jail and not in bars yet. Because I end up spending 30 days, guys. 30 days. I end up
jeez.
And for me, as bougie as I am, and as like prima donna, oh my God. So I go in, they end up finding out it's a mistake. So after like 2.5 hours, because I'm like, what the fuck is going on? So they come to me and they're like, oh, you know, we're terribly sorry, but it was a mistake. And I'm like, oh my God. So I start throwing a fit. I sat here for 2 fucking hours for you guys. I told you, you know, that I didn't have to go to court and this. I'm like, I'm not walking out of here with something without anything. Like, I listen, Raquel, leave. Like, just walk out the door. Don't like try to get anything from them. They're going to give you like something you don't want. So of course they're like, well, we could give you a ticket for having an expired license. And I'm like, whatever, just give me a ticket, fine. And that ticket, apparently in the state of Florida, having an expired license for over 2 years is not good. Uh-oh. Because I traveled so much, so I didn't pay attention to my driver's license. So, sure. Oh my gosh, like somebody's calling in. Like, let me just stay there. Okay, so sorry, I didn't want to just keep beeping. So I, where was I at? Oh, so yeah, they give me a ticket for an expired driver's license, which you have to go to court for. You can't just go and get them redone. You have to go to court because they were expired for over 2 years. So I'm like, oh, I got this in the bag. You know, I'll wear a cute little outfit. I'll go in. Everything will be fine. Yeah, no. Once again, no. I go in and I didn't bring a lawyer with me because I thought, like I said, it was going to be something really stupid and like go in and they're going to say, like, get your license. Well, when the judge had asked me, you know, why is your license expired for 2 years? I'm like, well, because I travel, you know, I'm a model. Well, that probably didn't sound real well. I probably sound a little sarcastic. The DA jumps up. He's like, she cares about the date on her passport. And I'm like, well, yeah, because, I mean, I travel the country all the time. Like, I have a driver's license in Australia. I've got a driver's license. Yeah, you don't say that in front of a judge. Like, that might piss them off a little bit. Like, you don't. Kind of act a little bit more humble in front of them, which I was not pulling off. So he's like, 6 months probation. I'm like, what the fuck is probation? Like, what did I get myself into? Like, what? So they gave me probation. And at that time, I had no idea really what probation, like, I'm not a lawbreaker. Like, I've never been in trouble. And, you know, until I went to college for forensics, I really didn't know, like, exactly what could get you in trouble. So, you know, I leave with probation, and I didn't think that I could go get my license fixed until after probation. So when he sentenced me to probation, it was called a sentenced probation, which meant if I broke that probation, I would automatically, no matter what, have to spend 30 days in jail.
Oh, boy.
So... About 6 months in my probation, I think I had a little less than 2 months left. My neighbor ended up with a really bad fever, and the grocery store from my condo in the town, in the hometown that I lived in, was within walking distance. But I thought, well, I'll just, you know, it's 7:30 in the morning. I'll just jump in. You know, I've got Victoria's Secret PJs on. I'll just jump in with my PJs, run into the grocery store, grab some, you know, fever reducer, come back, you know, nothing's going to happen.
What color?
Nope. I get pulled over.
Okay.
So now I am pulled over without a driver's license on probation. So I start crying. I'm like, no, please. This might violate my probation. And he's like, well, here's the ticket, you know, you're just going to have to give it to your probation officer and talk it out with him. And I'm like, oh my God. So I remember calling my probation officer at like 9 o'clock. I'm like, I think I violated my probation. He's like, how did you do that? And I will never forget. It was on the 23rd of June. And because I had to see him on the 29th. And I said, I don't know what to do. And he's like, when are you supposed to come in? I said, the 29th. And he's like, just come in on the 29th. I'm like, oh, cool. I'm like, okay, thanks. So I get off the phone. I'm like, oh, God, thank God. You know, he's not going to violate me. And so I went, you know, went around the rest of the couple days. So the 29th comes around and still no driver's license. Oh, no. At that time, he said, why haven't you gotten your driver's license? And I said, I didn't think I could get it because I'm on probation. He's like, no. You could have gone and gotten your license back. I suggest you to do that. So I'm in my mind thinking, oh, God, he's not going to, you know, he wants me to get my license back. He's going to give me a freebie, get a jail card. I'm cool. So I go, I get my driver's license back. But here's the clincher for Florida. If you go and pay for all whatever year your tickets are spread around, when you pay for all of them at one time, then they are paid for at one time, and each of them are considered however many points are considered. So instead of, like, say if I got one in 91 and I paid for it in 91, okay, well, that's paid for. If it had a point, then it would be 1 point. Then in 92, 93, if I don't get in trouble or don't pay for a ticket or if I don't get a ticket or whatever, then there's no points. Do you guys get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So if you go in there and you pay for like $1,200 worth of tickets at one time and you get 18 points, you automatically become, which they don't tell you this, there's not a handbook, you get to be a habitual traffic offender, but they don't tell you. Shit. They gladly hand you your license and like, okay, here's your license. Bye. So I leave it. I'm like, oh, I got my license. I'm on probation, but I got my license. I think he's totally going to get, you know, I'm Raquel Darringer. I mean, he's going to let me go. Right. So I go on the 29th and, you know, have my new license. I go in and he's, like literally shoves paperwork across the desk and I'm like, am I off probation? He's like, oh yeah, you're on probation. I'm like, oh, he's like, you're with the state now. And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, you violated. And I'm like, oh my God, you violated me? He's like, yeah, you violated your probation. You drove without a license. I'm like, I didn't know, you know, once again, you know, I didn't know. So, I ended up going back to court and they were like 30 days. So I ended up spending 30 days and listen to me when they told me, you know, I have acrylic nails on, I have a face regimen, you know, I have things that I do on a daily basis that apparently they do not allow at the bed and breakfast of jails in, at least in Florida. No nails, but no fills for your nails, you know, no, you know, special conditioning or masks for your face, you know, things that someone like me would be used to. So they brought me in, and when I first went in, I'm like, I can't go in the regular one. I've seen how those girls act. I don't want my panties stolen. Like, I have an anxiety problem. I'm going to have a seizure. So they put me in this cute little room and they, first of all, tried to take my Victoria's Secret wires out of my bra. And I'm like, dude, listen, you don't even know how much that bra cost me. You're not taking the wires out of it.
What color?
I just won't wear one. And that's the way we'll roll. So I didn't have on a bra. I had on like a fluorescent pair of like, thong, you know, cause it was early back in the early 90s or mid 90s, I should say. Yeah. So they put me in this room. It's got a medical bed. It's got a shower. It's got a TV and it's got a phone. So I'm like, okay, well, I mean, wow. If I'm going to have to spend 30 days, then I guess this is the way to do it. You know, personal, I guess, cause I'm Raquel Darringer. I guess this is why I get my own private suite. No, I'm in medical, guys. They're observing me to make sure I don't have a seizure so they can throw me in with right. All the other ladies. Yeah. But I don't know that at first. So I go in there with an attitude. They want me to put on this jumper, and I'm like, fuck that shit. I'm not wearing that orange thing. No. So I'm like walking around the room naked, and they keep on an intercom. They keep going, put on your clothes, Raquel, put on your clothes. And I'm like, no. And I'm like, looking at them all. Like, I'm not very nice and not realizing I've got to spend 30 days with these people and they are being nice to me right now because they don't want to trigger a seizure. Well, once they realize that I don't have a seizure, they come back in and they're like, and then once I realize they're videoing me or they're watching me, I like start doing like, you know, HBO real sex in the shower, you know, like, hey, you know, I'm like doing everything just to be a smart ass. So I'm sure they were like, oh, she has no idea where she's about to go in 4 days. So I'm in there for 3 days talking to calling everybody collect on the phone. You know, I'm in jail. I'm doing time in the clink, you know, all that. And my friends are like, oh my God, my parents are freaking out. Everybody's going nuts. And, yeah, so then they come and get me, and they're like, okay, Raquel, it's time to leave. And I'm like, oh, am I out? And like, you're out of medical. And I'm like, what do you mean out of medical? Like, where are we going? They're like, oh, no, you're going to the real jail now. Like, you're going to the... Yeah. I'm sorry, Raquel. Did you think that this door... You know, and the quietness and your private TV and remote and then your electric bed and, you know, all of that was for 30 days. And I'm like, yeah. They're like, no, we just wanted to make sure you weren't going to have a seizure. You're fine. You can go in with the rest of the girls. And I'm like, oh, my God. I'm like, put me in the smallest cell you have. Okay, well, then that gets me in another situation because the smallest cell is called lockdown.
Yep.
So lockdown is where very few women who cannot be controlled and act accordingly in the regular population get stuck in what's called lockdown. So they, upon my request, because I didn't know, I'm like, I'll go into that cell, you know, with the, just the four girls. Okay, well, those four girls, they're like the badasses that can't handle being with the rest of the crowd. So I walk in, there's one girl wearing a pair of stripes, and then there's three others that are wearing, no, there's two other, because there's only four of us. So one's wearing stripes, two other girls are wearing orange, and then I come in. And I'm like, listen, I'm like, do you see these? I show them my nails. I'm like, I am not here to fight. I'm bringing kindness and positivity. Okay, they don't really give a fuck. They're in jail. Like, they could care less about Raquel Darringer rolling up in the jail cell saying, you know, I bring positive vibes. They don't care. They're in jail. So I go in, and I end up making friends with all of them, and then I end up literally, I read the rule book in one night and found out, listen, prisoners have a lot, inmates have a lot more privileges than they really know. Because I read, like I said, I read the whole rule book, like, in the first night. Now, one, my uncle had just retired from the jail. So he knew the warden really, really well. So it was already a phone call to the jail saying, hey, listen, don't let anything happen to her. And kind of, you know, she's a little extra. Just leave her alone. She might have a smart mouth. Just kind of leave her alone. So I already had a little bit of a one up, but I made things worse for myself with my mouth. But so I read the rule book to find out that, like, at 4:30 in the morning, when they would usually wake up, like, the cellmates to, like, clean their cell and all that, lockdown, you don't have to, because we are in lockdown. Where else are you going to put us if we break the rules? We are the rule breakers. So once I found that out, I'm like, the girls are all jumping up the very first time. Mary May, who the fuck would name their kid Mary May? Miss May was her name, but her first name is Mary. She comes down banging on the wall, on the damn, like, the bars, and she's like, wake up. It's like 4:30 in the freaking morning, and I'm like, hold up, I'm not waking up. Like, I don't have to wake up. Like, I don't have to do shit. Like, I'm in jail, if you haven't noticed. Like, I'm behind bars. And what are you gonna do to me? Like, what are you gonna, they can't not feed you. You know, they can't not treat you humane. So you can pretty much just tell them to fuck off, because you're in jail. Like, what are they going to do? Like, put you in a special ed jail? Like, what are they going to do? So I'm like, the girl's like, oh my God, Raquel, you're going to get us in trouble. I'm like, we're already in trouble. You're in trouble because you're in stripes. Like, you're apparently going to stay here for a lot longer than I am. And then, you know, you for whatever you've done, and you. They can't do anything to us. The only way you can get more time is if you put bodily harm on a CO. So as long as you can crap talk them, you can do whatever you want. You don't have to do anything. We don't have to listen to anything they say, because they can't do anything to us. They just didn't realize a smart person was going to walk in there and read the damn code book. So I'm like, yeah, that shit's not going to roll with me. Like, so I climbed back over. I took off my jumper because I didn't like the way it felt. And I went back to sleep. So after they realized, like, oh shit, like, she's no joke. Like, she did read the rule book. She's going to be a problem for us for 30 days. Well, then I complained about everything. They're supposed to turn off the lights at a certain time. They didn't. So I'd call. They can't deny us, like, to talk to, like, the lieutenant or the sergeant. So I'm like, I need to talk to the sergeant. And they're like, you can see them, but they're rolling their eyes like, oh my God. And so a sergeant would come down. I'm like, listen, it's past 11. They didn't turn off the lights. I'm not getting good sleep. These lights are made to, like, make you crazy. You need to turn them off. So then the COs would get in trouble. So of course that would piss them off with me. But again, what can they do? nothing. So I just like waved to him like, hi. So then you were supposed to keep your jumper on. No, I didn't. I always ran around a pair of socks, pair of underwear, and a bra. I did end up, my parents ended up bringing bras to me because they're like, you know, you can't just run around without a bra on. And so, yeah, I did that. And I told all the girls, I got them together, and I like counseled them. And Jamie, you probably could get this feeling from how I do like my TikToks, how I kind of like counsel people. They get on, they're like, you've had a bad day. I'm like, hey, listen, I'll pull you out and you and I will talk, you know? And so I did this with these girls, and I was like, well, listen, why don't we all get our rap sheets just to see, you know, like what all everybody's done. Okay. Remember guys, I'm in there for a traffic violation. Like I have one, like I have like a sticky note, like my rap sheet is a sticky note. These girls, and you know, you can ask for your rap sheet and they have to bring it to you, you know? So I'm like, we need all of our rap sheets. And I'm sure they're laughing about me like, okay, sticky note, because you're going to get one little piece of paper that says like traffic violation and violated probation, you know? And so they bring everybody's rap sheets in. I swear to God, these girls had fucking books. Like they had books of rap sheets. Me, they literally give me one sheet of paper. So the girls are looking at me like, you act like you're this badass. You're coming here telling us what to do. And you have like one sheet of paper. I'm like, it's a traffic violation. Like, and they're like, what? I'm like, yeah, I didn't have, you know, I violated probation. I mean, hey. And the other one's like, I'm in here for like murder. The other one was in there for like crack. You know, I'm like, you know, I'm reading their rap sheets and I'm like, oh my God, girls, you need to get your shit together. Like, do you want to spend the rest of your life in here? So now I break it down and start counseling these chicks. And I'm like, listen, you know, when you get out, you don't need to do drugs. And the next one, when you get out, you don't need to be a prostitute. And, you know, the next one, you don't talk to them. And the one in stripes, I'm like, you're never getting out. So, I mean, you do what you want. Like, YOLO, you know, you're stuck in here. Like you made the wrong choices. So I would read to them every night, Harry Potter, and I would change my voice, and they would lay in their beds like little kids and they would listen to me read. So I read them every night. And then literally, you know how like you clap your hands twice, like the clapper, and it turns off the lights.
Right.
That's what I would do. And it would be like, Raquel means it's time for bed. So, like, I would clap my hands twice, and it was, like, time for bed. The girls would all lay in their bed. It would be time to go to bed. And so, I mean, we kept our cell. We called it a suite. I told them we could not call it a cell anymore. It was a suite. If I was going to spend 30 days in there, we were going to make the best of it. So I had them do – I lost – and I was already really, really skinny, but I lost probably about 17 pounds and probably gained muscle because every day we did aerobics. And sit-ups, push-ups, oh my God, Mary May really hated me. She'd be like, girls, you need to put on your outfits. I'm like, no, we don't. Like, what the fuck are you going to do? Like, make us get a lockdown. We're already in lockdown. So, I mean, we would all be doing, like, high kicks and sit-ups and, you know, we'd sing. Of course, we had no music. So, you know, I made the best of it. Like, I made the best of it. Raquel Darringer rocked it. You know, I went in there and said, okay, this is what they gave me. All right, I'll rock it. I won't lie. You know, every time I saw my parents on visitation or anything like that, I'm like, oh, my God, I can't handle it. But, I mean, I was handling it. I was handling it okay. So, yeah, the whole time. And then there was one other incident that a trustee came in and had, like, slid someone's food underneath the bars. And one of the girls went to pick it up. And I'm like, don't pick that up. Don't pick that up. I went to the trustee. I said, do we look like dogs? And they're like, what? I'm like, does any of us, like, do we look like, you know, canine animals of any sort? And I'm like, huh? I'm like, I need a sergeant. So the sergeant comes down. I'm like, do we look like dogs? You know, I said, did the same thing to him. And he's like, what the fuck are you talking about, Rick? Like, you annoy the shit out. Like, what? Can we just let you out early? Like, what? I'm like, they put the food on the floor and they push it through and we're not picking it up. You're going to have to get your trustee to come in here and pick this up. The girls aren't doing it. I'm not going to let them pick food up from off the floor. I want you to know that trustee came back in and picked that fucking food up off the floor. And then they were all able to sit at tables. So, yeah, I was bossy, and I spent 30 days in jail. Everybody knows now. Nice. But I made the best of it. And, you know, when I got out, I learned speeding probably wasn't like the best thing to do. But yeah, there's my jail story. I spent 30 days in jail. Most people don't know that. They don't know that, like, yeah, I spent 30 days.
That was definitely.
It was, but like, you could only, and another thing, I shave my legs every day. Like, I have a major thing about, like, shaving. And you can only have a razor, like, every Wednesday. So that was, like, probably the most torturous thing that I had to do.
It had to be torturous.
That, and then my, when I went to see the judge that sentenced me to the 30 days, when I went back to see him, because you have to have a first arraignment or whatever, I started crying because he's like, so you do understand that you're in your, and I start crying, I'm like, you're the one that put me here. And I'm like, yeah, calm down. You know, I'm like, you put me in here for 30 days. And he's like, yeah, I did. And I mean, I had an attorney, and even the attorney tried to get me 15 days. I could have gotten out in 15 days, but I would have been put back on probation. And honestly, I was having so much fun with aerobics and shit that I was like, fuck it. I'm not coming out with probation. I'll just sit 30 days and, you know, drive everybody nuts and write complaints every day. So, you know, I taught them how to write. There was one girl that didn't know how to write cursive. So I taught her how to write cursive. And like, I made the best of it. So
That's like $1 million. Raquel, that's like $1 million movie idea right there. Seriously, you can write that down.
Many people. I'm actually writing a book, and that will be in the book. And a lot of people have said, because when I tell them the story, they're like, if we did not know you, like, we would not believe 90% of the shit you say, because it's so outlandish. And I'm like, it's just me, you know, it's just who I am. So they approached me at one time and they said, do you want to do a reality show? And I'm like, well, you know, because I have a daughter, and I'm like, I've been in front of the camera, and, you know, I know how the paparazzi and stuff can be very, very cool and not give you your space. And it just kind of just wasn't something that I was really interested in doing, because mainly because my daughter, I just didn't want to have to, you know, have a camera in front of me all the time. But then again, like, I, you know, I am writing the book. Sometimes I do, like, it was going to be called Raquel's World, You Just Live in It. So, I thought about it, and then I'm like, no, but now I'm thinking about doing, either something on YouTube or something. I don't know. I know a lot of people, so I don't know. I'm going to do something, but it is going to be something along lines, because we negotiated, we never signed, so I can still use the idea, because it was my idea, really, was that it's Raquel's World, You Just Live in It. So I don't know exactly what I'm going to do with it, but it is either going to be like a radio show or some sort of platform on YouTube. TikTok, definitely not, because I've gotten banned like 4 times. They hate me there. They freaking hate me. I show too much breath, or I have too much of an opinion or whatever, and they ban me. So, and now I'm shadow banned, and the only people that will watch me is Brazilians. And I mean, which is fine, but like, Americans just are like, they have no idea that I'm even on live. Jamie, you know, like, you go, like, they don't even, they're like hiding me right now. Yeah. So I'm like, I'm over that. So yeah, so I am going, that is, they're wondering like if my book is ever going to get finished, but yeah, so I have quite a few interesting stories.
Raquel,
this will be the last time I hope I'm on your show.
Oh, dude. Dude, I definitely got to have you back on sometime. We definitely would love to have you back on. Listen, we killed a lot of time. And we had some awesome stories, and we really, really appreciate it. We wanted to thank you for coming on. And
thank you.
We're going to have you back on again, and maybe like next season or something, because that was some more stories.
Absolutely. I would love it, guys. I really, definitely, I appreciate so much. I'm honored that you guys asked me to come on. Jamie, thank you so much. And I really appreciate it. It was a lot of fun. And definitely, definitely, I'm definitely tuned into you guys. And I listened to a couple of your last season podcasts, and I'm definitely considering, I'm not considering, but I'm listening to the rest of them, and I will definitely continue to listen. And hopefully, yeah, you guys will have me on again, because I would love it.
Thanks, Raquel. Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you. Have a great night. Take care.
You too. Thank you guys so much for having me on. I totally appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us for the Two Stone Dudes podcast. Unfortunately, we took up all the time that we originally planned to use for this show, so it's all good. We got it with one good interview with Raquel, and man, what an
awesome
interview that was.
Awesome.
Did you guys have fun?
Oh, definitely. Blast.
I left my ass off.
Nice. She's a sweetheart.
Tell some great stories. She has absolutely. Great stories.
That story about her being in prison is like a... I pictured it as a movie. In my head.
Right.
Yeah. I totally pictured it as a movie in my head.
Almost like Mean Girls.
Right. Yeah.
But
yeah.
in like a prison sentence with one chick.
What'd you say?
On Wednesdays.
What'd you say your book name was? This is Raquel's World? Or
something? Yeah.
Yeah.
On Wednesdays we wear orange.
Yeah, that's definitely a book title or a video or something.
Dude, yeah. Definitely.
There's a lot of products that could
That's
all right, guys. We'll see you guys here back next week. Take care. Have a good night.